You know, I am super jacked up to be here today. Yesterday, I was at the Texas Baptist Convention, and because of the ice and snow, we had a record low attendance. A couple weeks ago, I was at Utah-Idaho Convention. Next week, I'm going to be in New Mexico. This week, I'm going to be on the campus of Liberty University, but absolutely, this is the truth. The thing I'm most excited about is being right here, right now. Because I love the SBCV. I get, of all the conventions, and I'm not just saying this, I love the SBCV. And I love the prayer initiative. And I love the fact that you guys hire a guy to just provoke prayer. I teach at a seminary, and I put two classes, had to get into the curriculum. One was one on prayer and spiritual formation, and the other was prayer and spiritual warfare. If you don't know me, you're probably thinking, who is this weird little guy? Dave Early, big deal. What, they didn't have any money in the budget, so they got Dave Early. Sometimes if you're an ordinary-looking guy or less than ordinary, if you got a good-looking family, it raises people's expectation of the message. So I got a picture of my family I want to show you real fast. You got that slide, or am I messing you up? Well, yeah, sometimes it's like that. I can't say that. You know, we are talking about spiritual warfare, so just expect stuff, okay? Well, a lot of you have asked me about Las Vegas, and I was teaching at Liberty. We love teaching at Liberty. It was awesome. Center for Ministry Training, the Center for Church Planting, also getting to teach undergrad. It was incredible. All my kids were at Liberty. Actually, you do got my family. There you go. See, I have a good-looking family. So you look at my family and you go, well, there must be something about this guy more than what he looks like, because he does have a good-looking family. So I am blessed. Well, I was teaching at Liberty, and I was teaching a class at Church Planters several years ago, and we were in Matthew 16:18. Jesus said, I will build my church, and the gates of hell will not prevail against it. And you know, when you're a professor, you can say lots of stuff. And so I made a brass statement. I said, I believe if we would learn to cooperate with Jesus in planting churches, you can start a church anywhere, and it would kick down the gates of hell. Now, the interesting thing is, when you say stuff, God listens too. And honestly, I felt the Holy Spirit speaking to me and saying, Dave, do you really believe what you just said? And I'm like, yeah. And I felt God said, find the gates of hell and start a church. A little over, almost 3 years ago, we moved to Las Vegas, Nevada. Also known as what city? Sin City. Paul wrote the Romans, he said, where sin abounds, grace should abound that much more. I was speaking to a new convert in Las Vegas a couple years ago, and I said, why should I leave my life on the East Coast? Why should I leave my ministry at Liberty? Why should I move to Las Vegas, the area we were looking at that was the least churched and the least reached, with a nasty area near the university, six gangs, a bunch of drug addicts, a bunch of drug dealers, homeless people, pimps, prostitutes, college students. I'm like, why would I leave my life at Liberty and in Central Virginia and go start a church here? And he said, I don't know much, but I do know this. I read in this morning that Paul said something like this. He says, where sin abounds, grace should abound that much more. And then he said this, why don't you start Grace City Church to see Sin City transformed into Grace City? Well, Kathy and I and my son Andrew spent a year praying in the prayer chapel at Liberty. Almost 3 years ago, the three of us plus 17 other young adults moved to Las Vegas. Some came for a summer, some a semester, some a year to start Grace City Church. And I have to tell you, hardest thing I've ever done. I've started churches before. I've done a lot of ministry in a lot of places. I lived in Manhattan down with just Nasty Park for a period of time doing ministry out of a warehouse. Hardest thing we've ever done, but we've seen God do more in 2.5 years. You got two little cards on your table. One is called the Missionary Experience, and that's about coming and spending 10 weeks with us. If you got young adults in your church, we still have some slots open for the summer. And the other has several things. The Vegas Experience is when your church group comes out for a week. And what's exciting is the churches that have come out and spent a week with us, what they tell us when they go back is their people are more fired up about prayer and evangelism than ever before, and they're taking what they learn in Las Vegas into their neighborhoods. All right, tell the person next to you, when's he going to get into the spiritual warfare part? Go ahead. Okay, here we go. It's about 20 years ago, and my understanding of spiritual warfare at that time was theological, intellectual, and biblical. But one day that all changed. It all became very experiential. I woke up on a Tuesday morning in incredible pain. I looked and I had a big welt on my arm, a boil, about the size of a dime, swollen, pussy, painful. And I looked and there was another. I took off my shirt and my shorts and I had 22 boils. Kathy called and got me into the doctor. The doctor examined me head to toe, top to bottom, everything I'd eaten, everywhere I'd been. He checked everything he could check and then he did this. Look at me. He went, "Now, you don't want your doctor to go like this." I said, "What?" He said, "I don't know what to tell you." He said, "Never, ever have I ever heard of anybody getting 22 boils overnight all at once." And he stopped and he said, "Except in the book of Job." He's a Christian. And he said, "This is spiritual warfare." He said, "What are you preaching on Sunday?" And I said, "Well, I'm starting a new series, Angels, Demons, and Spiritual Warfare." He said, "Bingo." He said, "Look, I'm going to give you some cream that might relieve the pain a little bit, but you come back Friday. If they're not all gone, and they won't be, I've got to use the razor blade and lance each one." I went home and went to bed and told Kathy. Kathy called up some prayer warriors in our church. Went back to the doctor on Friday, and he examined me again, top to bottom, head to toe, and again he did this. And then he smiled, and he said, "I don't know what to tell you." He said, "I've never heard of anybody getting so many boils so quickly, except in the book of Job, and I've never heard of anybody getting rid of them so quickly. They are all gone." Say, "Yay, God." Now, I realized something at that time, that spiritual warfare wasn't just something in a book. It wasn't just something out there. It wasn't just something somewhere else. It was right here, right now, in my church, in my family, in my body, in my situation. The reality is, you in your church, in your situation, you're probably facing a lot more spiritual warfare than you stop to realize. We need to pray. I want you to just put your hand on the person next to you, and I want you to ask that God would just protect their thoughts and minds right now so that God can say everything he wants to say to us in this room. The enemy would have no place to hinder. Go, pray. God, we pray in the name of Jesus for that angelic hedge, that wall around us, that wall of fire, God, as we talk about these things. May Jesus Christ be exalted highly in this room. In his name we pray, amen. Take your Bibles and turn to Ephesians chapter 6, and we're going to look at a passage of Scripture. As I told you, I created a class for Liberty called Strategic Prayer and Spiritual Warfare, and we actually spend about 10 lectures on this passage, and I don't have time for that today, so I'm going to give you a flying overview and hit some highlights that we need to understand if we're going to be effective in spiritual warfare. I'm going to begin reading in Ephesians chapter 6 and verse 10. Finally, be strong in the Lord and in his mighty power. Put on the full armor of God so that you can take your stand against the devil's schemes. For our struggle is not against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against the authorities, against the powers of this dark world, and against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly realms. Therefore, put on the full armor of God so that when the day of evil comes, you may be able to stand your ground, and after you have done everything, to stand. Stand firm, then, with the belt of truth buckled around your waist, the breastplate of righteousness in place, your feet fitted with the readiness that comes from the gospel of peace. In addition to all this, take up the shield of faith with which you can extinguish all the flaming arrows of the evil one. Take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God, and pray in the Spirit on all occasions with all kinds of prayers and requests. With this in mind, be alert and always keep on praying for all the Lord's people. Pray also for me that whenever I speak, words may be given to me so that I will fearlessly make known the mystery of the gospel for which I'm an ambassador in chains. Pray that I may declare it fearlessly as I should. Notice the whole book of Ephesians. He's talking about our position in Christ. It crescendos into spiritual warfare, and the teaching on spiritual warfare climaxes on prayer. We fight this battle on our knees. Look, in every other continent, the church is expanding and growing because they understand that the church marches on its knees. In America, where we have all our stuff, the church is shrinking and declining. Because as we heard this morning, we're depending on ourselves and not depending on God. Let me ask you a question, and I want you to actually participate in this question. How many of you believe God can do things bigger than you can? Keep them up there. How about faster than you can? How about more long-lasting? How about better than you can? You may put your hands down. It came to me, God gave me that question one day when I was teaching, and it came to me that if I really believed that, my prayer life would reflect it. In Las Vegas, every morning at 9 a.m., there's at least 20 people in a room where we do word-fed, spirit-led, worship-based prayer an hour and a half every day. Before our worship service, 50 minutes before our worship service, there's a whole bunch of people gathered together doing worship-based prayer that God would work that day. Jesus said that his passion is that the people of God be a house of prayer for all nations. We can talk about evangelism, we can talk about discipleship, we can talk about church planting, we can fund all those things, but until we pray, we are not going to see the move of God. Ephesians chapter 6, I'm going to give you three big thoughts. Number one, the war is real. The war is real. Francis Schaeffer said, "We're locked in a battle, not a friendly gentleman's discussion. It's a life and death conflict between the spiritual hosts of wickedness and those who claim the name of Christ." A.W. Tozer said, "The idea that the world is a playground instead of a battleground has now been accepted in practice by the vast majority of Christians." C.S. Lewis said, "There's no neutral ground in the universe. Every square inch Every split second is claimed by God and counterclaimed by Satan. John Eldridge, three eternal truths. Things are not what they seem. The world is at war. Each of us has a crucial role to play. The story of your life is the story of a long and brutal assault on your heart by the one who knows what you could be and fears it. Listen to Rick Warren. If you're in the ministry, you're going to face opposition from the devil. He's opposed to everything you stand for. He hates anybody who sold out to Jesus Christ. He will do anything he can to defeat you. Stu Weber said, every Christian who wants to make a difference can count on living in the crosshairs of the enemy. The war is real. It's not just in Africa. It's not just in Asia. It's not just in the inner cities. It's right here, right now. It says, put on the full armor of God so that you can take your stand against the devil's schemes for our struggle, or we wrestle not against flesh and blood. The word wrestle carries the idea of the fact that we are in a battle. He says, we wrestle, not I wrestle, not they wrestle, we wrestle. We are in the battle. Turn to the person next to you and go, say, you're in a war. We are in a war. We are the battleground. Now think about it. God is omnipotent. God is omniscient. God is invincible. There's no way the adversary, the opposer, can defeat God. So what's he do? He attacks what God loves. Look, if you're trying to get to Superman, you're not going to have much luck, so you go after Lois Lane. If you want to get to Batman, you go after Mary Jane. Satan wants to attack God. He goes after that which God loves. God's only weakness in the battle is that God loves people. Before you're saved, Satan works full time to keep you from being born again. After you're born again, the battle's over, right? No way. He works just as hard to keep you effective, for being effective for God. Screwtape Letters, one chapter, pre-salvation, 30 chapters of the battle of the enemy against a man who'd become a Christian to keep him from effectiveness. Tell the person next to you, we are in a war. We're in a war. We are the battleground. And it's intense. The word wrestle is the idea of two warriors locked, hand-to-hand combat. They're squared off, middle of a battlefield, they're squared off, and only one of them is going to walk away alive that day. Look, we think we can just play games and win souls. Those days are over. Let's talk about under 30 population, 6% active in Christianity. We're this close to losing a generation. Look, if we don't get serious about prayer, the party's over. We are in a war. And it's serious. It's life and death. Number two, the war is against the devices of the devil. It says, put on the whole armor of God so that you may stand against the wiles, the schemes of the devil. 2 Corinthians chapter 2 and verse 11, it says, lest Satan should take advantage of us, for we are not ignorant of his devices. Did Jesus defeat Satan on the cross? Absolutely. You know, you can cut the head off a rattlesnake and it can still bite you and kill you. Satan knows time's ticking. The serpent's putting on a final effort. We need to understand how he operates. It says in verse 12 that we have the devices of the devil, and then it says against principalities, powers, rulers of the darkness, spiritual hosts of wickedness in heavenly places. It's talking about the strata of demons. we call demons, fallen angels. And this is a military ranking. This is a like a political structure in which they operate. Do you know that angels are warriors? They're not cute, cuddly babies. Every time an angel shows up, read your Bible. First thing they say is, fear not. Why? Because they scared the heck out of people. Demons are fallen angels. They are warriors. They are strategic. They are intentional. And they are our adversary. Now, I'm going to quickly give you an overview of some of the names of the enemy, and that will tell us his devices. The first is opposition. Opposition. Understand that if you are living for God, you will face opposition. The very word Satan means adversary, opposer. He opposes everything about God. He brings opposition. We started a church in Las Vegas. We're meeting in a middle school. You got to understand, that as we prayer walked around that school for a month to get in, because not every school will take you. Mormons pretty much control so many positions of power in Las Vegas. UNLV is built around a Mormon church. We get a call at 4:29 on Friday afternoon saying, we're sorry, your paperwork's not correct. You can't meet in the school on Sunday. Gee, thanks. Could have called us on Monday. We could have corrected this. We happened to be in 21 days of prayer, and we had a prayer meeting that night. They're like, everybody's like, what are we going to do? What are we going to do? I'm like, let's ask God. We prayed, and we felt like God wanted us to just have church in the park in January in Las Vegas, which is dicey. Doesn't rain much in Las Vegas, but it does in January. Happened to be the only weekend of the month, raining all day Saturday. I stood with a group of people under a little pavilion watching the water dropping off the edge saying, okay, God, we need you. We got opposition here. We need you to stop the rain, send enough wind to dry up the ground so that we can have church in the park, and send some sun so it warms up a little bit. Rained all day. Raining into the night. People are calling me, what are we going to do if it's raining? What are we going to do if it's raining? Woke up Sunday morning, sun was out. Nice breeze blowing. Went to the park. We had same number of people we always had. About six people got saved. Happened to be a writer there, an atheist from the Las Vegas Weekly. He'd heard about our homeless ministry. He heard about our collegiate ministry. He heard about some of the people we were reaching. He was writing an article on us. He was completely blown away by church in the park. We had church, and then we had a big block party, and everybody in the park, we just fed and had a ball. About 3 weeks later, people start calling me up, and they said, do you see the Las Vegas Weekly? There's a picture of me on the cover. Went to 387,000 people. Satan meant it for evil, but God meant it for good. I got a question for you. This is a question. How big is God? And the answer is big enough. Let me ask you again. How big is God? Big enough. Hey, you will have opposition. But God is how big? Big enough. But we won that in prayer. We won that battle in prayer. Let me give you a second name for the enemy. Not only is he the opposer, but he's the accuser. When you say devil, you are saying accuser. You are saying slanderer. That's what diablos means in Greek. The slanderer, the accuser, the one who trips us up. Now, at every moment, I think Satan is making five accusations are going on. Number one, he is accusing you to God. Dr. Lawless mentioned that earlier today, where in Job, Satan says, you know, God says, my servant Job, he's a great guy. And Satan says, take away his blessings and he'll curse you. You're not worthy of worship without blessing. He was accusing Job to God. So I don't understand how it all works, but he's telling God bad things about you, as if God doesn't know. Second, he tells you bad things about God. He accuses God to you. Genesis 3, Satan basically said to Eve, God's not good and he doesn't keep his promises. Look at me for a second. How many of you have ever had this thought? The Bible is not true. Come on. How about there really isn't a God? How about there is a God, but he doesn't love me as much as he loves somebody else? Where do those thoughts come from? The accuser. Third, he accuses you to other people. That means he tells other people bad things about you. Man, he does this in Las Vegas all the time. I started church in Ohio. We started with, we moved on Saturday with 12 people, started with 12 people on Sunday. We ended up with about 2,000 by the time it was over. It's not over. When I resigned there and went to Liberty, church is still going. We were in somewhat early stages of that church, and I was calling people that I hadn't seen in a while. So I called a lady named Jenny, and I said, Jenny, we missed you. She said, no, you haven't. And I said, excuse me? She said, you haven't missed me? You don't like me? In fact, last time I was there, I could tell from your eyes that you hate me. I said, really? You could tell from my, yeah, she said, yeah, the whole time you were preaching, you stared at me the whole time. And then you didn't even say goodbye to me on the way out. There were like 800 people there that day. I said, Jenny, this is the absolute truth. Before I called you, Kathy asked me who I was calling, and I said, I'm calling Jenny. And we both talked about how much we love you and how proud we are of you as a single mom for raising your daughter for the glory of God. I said, the honest truth is, never one moment in my life have I ever thought I did not like you. I said, where do you think that thought came from? She goes, the devil? Bingo! You got to pray against the spirit of accusation, because the enemy will accuse you to other people. He will cast negatively things you say, things you do. You'll get this download of negative thoughts. Number four, he accuses other people to you. He tells you bad things about other people. Kathy and I hadn't been married that long, and we had a discussion. Nod your head at me if you've been married and you know what I mean when you have a discussion. We had a discussion. So she did what wives often do when there's a discussion. She's banging around the kitchen, and I'm not very good at it, but I went out in the garage and banged around out there. And I'm banging around, and this thought keeps going through my head. Bad wife. Bad, bad wife. And I'm like, yeah, bad wife. What right does she have? Why, she doesn't love you. She doesn't even love me. She hates you. Why? Bang, bang, bad wife. She hates me. She wishes you were dead. What a bad wife. I'm in the middle of this, getting this download of negative things about my wife. The door opens. From the kitchen to the garage. It's Kathy. She got a little tear on her cheek. She said, honey, I love you. I said, you do? She said, yes. She said, I don't even know what we're arguing about. I said, I don't either. You don't want me dead? She's like, no. Let me ask you a question. Where did all those negative thoughts come from? The enemy, the accuser. I pray for people all the time. I pray that God would silence the voice of the enemy and amplify the voice of the Holy Spirit. You want to pray for lost people? That's how I pray. The last one, and this is the most debilitating for many of us, he accuses you to yourself. Look, if I could print out all your thoughts from the last week and look at all the negative ones you have about yourself, I mean, I could just highlight ones from the enemy. Now, he accuses in generalities. God convicts in specifics. So Satan accuses us with thoughts like, you're not any good. You never will be. You can't do it. You don't have what it takes. And you hear these accusations over and over again, and you start to believe them. And you don't live out who you could be. What you can do. He's an accuser. Number three, the third device of the enemy is very, very simple, is he tempts us. He tempts us. Jesus was led by the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted. 40 days and 40 nights, and afterwards he was hungry, and when the tempter came to him. Very first time Jesus in human form confronts the enemy, he's being tempted. Very first time we see Satan in the scriptures, in Genesis 3, he's tempting. He's a tempter. You go through some dry seasons in your marriage. Kathy and I have been married 33 years, and we do love each other a great deal. We were hitting a dry season. Busy with the kids, busy with the church. I was dealing with some issues with my health. My mom passed away, and I was just low, 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 low. You know, the enemy knows you. I get an email from my high school girlfriend. Dave, I read one of your books. I saw it in the airport. You're such a good writer. Then I get another one. You know, I really miss talking to you. Then I get another one. I think the best time of my life was when I was with you. Yeah, Satan's smart, isn't he? Good thing is, I understand that, and so my wife reads all my emails, so it was just not a problem. She's like, you think you're spiritually counseling this girl. So that's not what she's thinking about at all. Thank God. But he's a tempter. He knows your buttons, and he knows when and how to push them. Number four is a deceiver, which we could talk about for 2 days. He's a liar. He lies to you. All the time. Jesus said, you'll know the truth, and the truth will what? Set you free. That means the word know is the idea of, it's the word for intimate experiential knowledge. You experience truth, you experience freedom. Same way you experience lies, you experience bondage. We do a whole weekend called Freedom Encounter, where we confront lies with truth and call for repentance, and people experience freedom from hurts, habits, hang-ups, nightmares, addictions. God does incredible things. It's all about the truth setting people free. Number five, he's a destroyer. And we could talk for all the ways he tries to destroy us with distraction, with despair. I was in Utah speaking to the pastors of Utah and Idaho, and if you don't know much about it, Christianity is a cult in Utah. And I mean, these guys were beat up from the enemy, a lot of them. And I made a statement. I said, you know, several years ago I was teaching a bunch of missionaries to Hindus, Muslims, and Buddhists. And I said, I'm just curious. That mission didn't believe a lot. I mean, they didn't they weren't keen on spiritual warfare, but I just felt like I needed to ask this question. I said, how many of you, when you accepted the call to your mission field or when you first arrived, you started to wake up in the middle of the night with overwhelming sense of anxiety and depression? And I said, I wonder how many of you, when you got to your mission field, you started having nightmares? People started crying all around the room. At the break, missionaries just lined up and said, how did you know? Because he's a destroyer. I live in the suicide capital of the world. We're three times the national average. He's always lying to people. Those guys from Utah and Idaho, they all said, dude, you read our mail. I have church planters contact me a lot, and they said, you warned me. You're right. He wants to destroy us. He wants to destroy God's work through us. You say, Dave, that's bad news. Yeah, I got good news, though. I'm not done. Number three, the war is winnable. You can win. We do win. We are winners. Now, it's interesting. I don't fully understand how it all works, but a sovereign God has chosen to limit much of his activity on earth to his body. If you read this passage, you find out there's all sorts of stuff we are supposed to do. We're supposed to stand firm. We're supposed to be strong in. We're supposed to put on. We're supposed to lift up. We are supposed to pray. There's our part and God's part. We win, but we got to do our part. Turn to the person next to you and go, you got to do your part. You got to do your part. Because we do have weapons that are powerful through God to the demolition of strongholds. And quickly, I'm gonna give you several of them. Number one is our identity in Christ. This is the foundation to victory in Christ. My identity, who I am in Jesus, 86 times in the epistles, 13 times in Ephesus, in the letter to the Ephesians. Paul talks about being in Christ. If you don't understand your identity, you're probably getting defeated by the enemy. Aaron mentioned it a little bit ago that 1 John, it says, little children, you're from God and overcome them. For he who is in you is greater than he who is in the world. We're the sons and daughters of the Most High God. Look at me for a second. This will mess you up. I have the same access and authority to the Father as does Jesus. Because I am in Christ and I am seated in him in the heavenlies at the right hand of the Father in authority. We're sons of the Most High God. We're saints. Over and over, Paul calls believers saints, not sinners. Look at me, pastors. Your people act like sinners because you're always telling them they're sinners. You know, not one place in the Bible is anybody called a sinner after they've been saved. It's not that, oh, we're just sinners saved by grace. No, we're saints. Saint means holy. That means I don't need to sin, want to sin, or have to sin. If your people are acting sinful, could it be because they don't know that they are saints? Turn to the person next to you and introduce yourself right now. I'm Saint David. I was doing that in a group of people one time, and this guy, he was like a deacon in the church, and he's like, uh-uh. I'm like, come on. He's like, uh-uh. I said, why not? What's your name? He said, Bernard. I'm like, okay, I get that. I get that. I'm a son. Repeat after me. I'm a son or daughter. I'm a saint. gets better. According to Romans 8:38, knowing all these things, we are more than conquerors. More than. Hooper. Super conquerors. Wait, look at me. You need to know who you are. Because the reality is, in Christ Jesus, I'm a son of the Most High God. I'm a saint through Christ Jesus. And I'm a super overcomer. You better watch out. You need to get up tomorrow morning and look in the mirror and go, Saint, super overcomer. Next time you get hit with temptation, this is what you say. That's not who I am. I'm a super overcomer. I'm a saint. I don't need that, want it, or have to do it. You got to know your identity. Number two, reconciliation. We don't think about it as spiritual warfare, but it's the whole basis of so much of it. It's making things right and living above offense. In Corinthians, Paul's talking, 2 Corinthians is written to tell them to forgive a guy, to reconcile. That's the point of the letter. And he says, I want you to do that so that we may not be taken advantage of by Satan. Some of you ought to go back to your church and preach on bitterness and reconciliation and how to make things right for about a month or two. You know, for some of your churches and some of your situations, revival looks like this. I was wrong. I'm sorry. Forgive me. I love you. Divide and conquer. Matthew 5 says that if I've offended you, I go to you. Matthew 18 says if you've offended me, I go to you. We have the obligation to make it right. Number three, the Word of God. All this armor stuff, and then he says, take up the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God. John 8:31. So Jesus said to the Jews that believed on him, if you abide in my word, you are truly my disciples. You will know the truth. The truth will set you free. 1 John 2:14. I write to you, young men, because you're strong. How do we get strong? The Word of God lives in you. If I'm strong because of the Word of God living in me, it says you've overcome the evil one. Now, I've grown a lot in my understanding since this day, but it wasn't all that long after the event with the boils. And we had a house church at my house on a Wednesday night, and everybody had just left. We just put the kids in bed. Phone rang. I said, hello, this is Dave. He said, yeah, this is Pastor Vic from the Columbus Baptist Temple. I said, Vic, I haven't talked to you in a while. He said, look, we got a situation and we want to know if you'd help us. I said, sure. What's the situation? He said, well, there's a woman in the hospital and she's suicidal and she's delusional and some other stuff. I said, what other stuff? He said, will you help us? I said, okay. And I said, what time you want to go tomorrow? He said, well, actually, I'm in your driveway. This is desperate. We need to go tonight. So I got in the car, Pastor Paul, Pastor Vic, Associate Pastor Paul, and we drove across town to a little hospital, went up at the top floor, go in, there's a young lady, her husband, and her mother. I'll call Grandma. Pastor Vic, he's a soul winner. He gets down and he says, you know, God loves you. Jesus died for you. And he starts into the Romans Road and absolutely no expression on this woman's face. He's like, I said, let me try something. I got down in front of her face and I said, repeat after me, Jesus Christ is Lord. Grandma tensed up. reared up, snarled. I said, repeat after me. I am washed in the blood of Jesus. Grandma began to cuss me out in a male voice. Now, I didn't know a whole lot about my authority at that time. So the way we worked it is we'd let the demon talk a while to hear why the demon thought he could be there, and then we'd shut the demon up, and we'd talk to Grandma about what she needed to do so that the demon didn't think he could be there. Well, it was late. You're getting this male voice yelling out vulgarities out this little lady. The nurses are all kind of freaked out. They're all peeking in, seeing what's going on. It's late, and I said, look, she's exhausted. We're tired. Let's come back. Let's finish this tomorrow. And pastoral visit, right? Got my Bible, took her hand, gonna pray. And all of a sudden, she rears up, and in that voice says, get the knives out of here. Get that knife out of here. I'm like, what are you talking about? There's no knives here. This is a hospital room. There are knives in this room. Knives all over this room. I said, really? How many knives are in this room? Five. Five knives. I look. I got a Bible. Pastor Vic's got a Bible. Pastor Paul's got a Bible. Daughter has a Bible. Son-in-law has a Bible. Five Bibles. We prayed, went down, got in the car. I said, what pastors say after unusual hospital visits? I said, that was an unusual hospital visit. Now, listen to me. This is what Pastor Paul said, and I will never forget it. He said, you know what really makes that unusual? He said, you know she's legally blind. Now, that moment, I got a big God bump right down my back. If I never believed in the Bible as the Word of God up until that moment, I did that moment. If I didn't believe in the power of the Word of God in spiritual warfare, I did that moment. Friends, you better watch out what you're holding, because this is the sword of the Spirit, the very Word of the living God. Well, we had a prayer meeting all the way back. It's like, let's pray for Grandma. Let's just go after it. We prayed all the way back. The next day, the phone rings. It's Pastor Vic, and I'm like, well, you going to pick me up? And he's like, don't have to. Like, what do you mean? He said, when we were having that prayer meeting on the way back, the daughter felt compelled to try one more time, and her mom renounced the lies she was believing in, renounced and resisted the devil, and accepted Jesus Christ as her Savior. Hallelujah. She said, she's no longer suicidal. She's no longer delusional. The hospital staff can't get over it. They said if this continues, she can go home on Friday. She did go home. Sunday morning, she walked the church of the aisle at the Columbus Baptist Temple, professed Jesus Christ as her Savior, got baptized, and never missed a Sunday until she went to heaven a few years later. How big is God? Look at me. Some of you are discouraged. I want you to know that you got what you need. In Christ, you are a super overcomer. You got the ability to humble yourself and say, I was wrong. I'm sorry. Please forgive me. And to lead your people into reconciliation. You need to understand that you have the very sword of the Spirit of God. The last weapon is pray. That's how he concludes. Pray, pray, pray. Pray all types of prayers in the Spirit on all occasions for all types of people. Pray for me that I can share the gospel boldly as I ought to speak. You know, we used to say there was hell in my house on Saturday nights. The kids would throw up. Kathy and I would have discussions. It was crazy on Saturday nights, especially if it was the day before a big day, when a lot of people could get saved. It was hell in my house on Saturday nights. I got a group of men in my church to pray. I asked my people to pray. The first time I humbled myself and said, look, I need you to pray for me, especially on Saturday nights. I need some of you to pray for me and fast one day a week. Woke up the next Sunday morning, and I hit me. That's the first Sunday since I started this church that I have slept through an entire night. Pray. 1 Peter 5, 6 through 8 says, humble yourself. You see, the greatest sign of spiritual independence is a lack of prayer. The greatest sign of spiritual independence is a lack of prayer. If you don't have a prayer life, you think that you can do it without God. Let me ask you, how's that working for you? How many of you believe God can do things bigger than you can? How about better than you can? How about faster than you can? How about more long-lasting? If you do, you will pray. Humble yourselves under the mighty hand of God. Cast all your anxiety on Him because He cares for you. Be self-controlled and alert because your adversary, the enemy, walks around like a roaring lion looking for somebody to devour. How many people are getting devoured because we don't pray? I can tell you story after story. I saw a guy in our morning prayer time delivered from meth in one day. That never happens. Meth is almost impossible to get free of. One of the interns at our staff, I could tell you his story. Grew up, his mom had four kids with four different men. Starting at the age of 15, she was a drug addict. She's no longer living. His father's in prison. He got radically freed by God, gave up a $400 a week drug addiction. He's on staff at our church. Tell you about my next door neighbor. We prayed in the prayer chapel for strategic, receptive people. This guy and his wife got born again, sharing Christ on his job, making six figures. They told him he couldn't talk about Jesus anymore. He said, I quit. That's Christianity. Took a job at a pawn shop. We have a few of those in Las Vegas. He said, I'll take this job, I'll manage this store for one thing, if you let me talk about Jesus. They said, these people need all the help they can get. You can talk about anything you want. Became known as the pawn shop preacher. People would line up outside his door to get in when the store opened so he could pray for them. Led his staff to Christ. He's in our Bible Institute. Our Bible Institute has two guys who were saved in prison, three former drug addicts, three former street people, two gang members, a PhD from UNLV. MTV heard about my neighbor and said, we want to do a TV show on you called The Pawn Shop Preacher. His company heard about it and said, we don't want that sort of publicity. He said, that you can't talk about Jesus? He said, I quit. He just started his next job. Hey, the war is real. But God is real. What if in the next 5-10 minutes, we begin to see God just pour himself out? Some of you, your heart's been burning. You've been burning to see a move of God. I'm going to lead you in some prayers. We're Baptists, so bow your heads and close your eyes. Here's the first brand, first bunch. God, forgive me. Whatever you need to tell God, forgive me. Just start out loud. Just say, God, forgive me. Your prayer life, your lack of prayer life, pride, bitterness, discouragement. God, forgive me. And let's let God hear our voice. God, help me. God, help me. Be specific. God, help me. God help me. Now put your hand on somebody next to you there and just out loud, ask God to change their prayer life the next couple months in a way that would be contagious and victorious for others. Just out loud, one after the other, you then the other one, just back and forth. Pray for that person. God would revolutionize their prayer life. Right now, out loud, let's pray for the prayer ministry of your church. Pray for the prayer ministry of your church. Don't pray against anybody, but pray for the prayer ministry of your church. Pray for the prayer ministry of this initiative Southern Baptists are rallying around. Pray for Virginia. Pray for this initiative that it would just catch fire. It would catch fire. Pray against everything that's holding back our prayer lives. Let's pray against discouragement. Just say, God, I say no to discouragement. I say no to discouragement. I say no to distraction. I say no to distraction. I say no to lesser things. I say no to lesser things. Pray for souls to be saved in all of our churches this Sunday. If you got a name, call that name out to God right now. Pray for souls to be saved this Sunday in your church. Call that name out if you know him. They say you know revival hits when God's people pray. Hey, we're going to win this. We got to pray.